Man is the most aggressive creature on Earth. Man is the most peaceful species on Earth. Which one of these statements is true? And the answer is both are. We are both capable of unbelievable aggression, violence, and cruelty. And at the same time, we have the ability to live in big groups in a very peaceful manner. Think of a pop concert, a big sports event, or a shopping mall. Thousands of encounters, thousands of possibilities for irritation, violation of private spaces, quarrel for resources, but fights and violence are extremely rare. If you think of it, you realize how special this is. How much violence did you see on the streets for the last 2 weeks? Not included what you saw on TV or other mass media. The answer for most people is possibly none. But when you read history books or look at TV news, we see violence in an unbelievable scale and of an unbelievable cruelty. In this brilliant book, Pinker shows some mind-boggling statistics. In some hunter-gatherer tribes, up to 60% of deaths of males was by violence of other males. And this was certainly not an exception. Luckily, the world has managed to contain aggression in an unimaginable fast and effective way. But our history shows it's nonetheless something that is part and parcel of our evolutionary makeup. Especially in combination with modern technology and big-scale bureaucratic forms of organization, this can have detrimental effects. Rwanda in the 90s of the 20th century and Auschwitz and the Third Reich are striking examples of this. What's going on here? How can this huge paradox be explained? What are the origins of our towering level of violence and our unimaginable ability for peace and cooperation? The ideas in this episode of this YouTube channel lean heavily on the work of Richard Wrangham, the goodness paradox. He comes up with some very remarkable insights on the evolution of the human species and sheds a revolutionary new light on aggression and violence. Wrangham presents some very intelligent and mind-boggling ideas on the relationship between aggression, cooperation, and the role the genders play in this phenomenon. First of all, Wrangham makes a sharp distinction between reactive and proactive aggression, that is, hot versus cold, impulses versus planned aggression. In contrast to most other species, humans score very low on reactive aggression, but very high on proactive aggression. In species like chimpanzees, wolves, and lions, but also in the males of a lot of other species, deer, sheep, birds, hot aggressions, impulsive reactions, and touchiness are daily business. Observations in chimps and humans have shown a factor of 100 to 1,000 times more incident of aggression among chimps than is occurring between even-sized groups of humans. Counts on carcasses of dead wolves show that around some 40% of them is victim of intraspecies violence, most of the perpetrators being males. But there have been also been cases affirmed of female aggressions with lethal consequences. Life is brutish and short for most individuals of most species, and their worst enemies are individuals of the same species and the same gender. What makes Homo sapiens so special, so different? People who knew him in private life speak of Adolf Hitler as a gentle, kind-mannered man. He loved animals, hated cruelty to them, and made several laws against the abuse of animals. He liked to be among children and was an affectionate man to his beloved wife, Eva Braun. When he personally witnessed executions, he was appalled and sick of the mere sight of it, turning his face off and walking away from it. Yet, on the other hand, he has cold-heartedly planned the mass murdering of millions, tens of millions of people in an industrialized and shockingly effective manner. Together with Stalin and Mao, Hitler is the biggest mass murderer in history. Here we see the huge gap between warm and cold aggression. Hitler being an example of extreme cold and fairly low reactive, impulsive, or warm aggression. Our ability to plan ahead, puzzling out the most effective way to kill others, our unmatched skills in communication and cooperations make us deadly effective killing machines. When we intend to murder, we do so in the most effective way. And Hitler is just one example of this. But you might argue, aren't humans anyhow the only species capable of cold aggression? We having this big brain, the ability to cooperate, and technology that can make our most cruel dreams come true. Yes and no. Indeed, it takes intelligence to perform cold killing, but we see it in many other species of animals too. Chimps are known to have planned raids on rival groups. Small bands of men go out and carefully choose the moment to strike. Also, wolves and lions seem to plan the hunting, be it on prey or competitors like hyenas or other prides of lions. So we are definitely not the only species capable of cold aggression, but in most other species, warm and cold aggression seem to go together. Only in Homo sapiens it does not. One cue to understand what's going on is to look at chimpanzees and their closely related cousins, the bonobos. Bonobos are much less aggressive than chimps. Conflicts are resolved by sex, grooming, and group interventions, and the role of males is much more limited than in chimps groups. Bonobos are the ideal and most beloved species of hippies and feminists. Females rule, and male aggression is dampened by bands of females. Free sex is an all-accepted habit, and newcomers are warmly welcomed. As a male, you can only rise to the top when supported by your mother. How different are chimps? In violent battles, males establish a hierarchy. Extreme violence to group members and especially to chimps from other groups are common. Males get females by intimidating and harassing them, forcing females to exchange sex for peace. I mentioned the aggression differences between chimps and humans. Bonobos score somewhere in between. Furthermore, there are some marked differences in appearance and physical gender differences. Body size and male-female differences are much bigger in chimps than in bonobos. The same goes for baboons and gorillas. All species known for their high hot and to some degree also their cold aggression. It seems like there has been some kind of special evolutionary trajectory that was going on in bonobos. What could that be? And are we talking about forms of natural selection or sexual selection, or both? We will answer these questions in a minute, and it has all to do with domestication, self-domestication in this case. So, first to understand this process in full depth, what exactly is domestication? And it's something different than most people think. Elephants can be tamed, but they are not a domesticated species. Every new elephant is captured in the wild and then tamed. It's too difficult to breed them. It would take too much time. Wolves also can be tamed, but they don't behave as dogs do, appear to be much more unpredictable, and can all of a sudden become very aggressive for no apparent reason. You cannot keep them as pets. This aggression is also visible among themselves. As told, up to 40% of wolves are killed by other wolves. Groups of feral dogs, domesticated but living in the wild, independent of humans, like dingoes do, they don't display this rate of violence. Their intraspecies killing rate rarely exceeds the 1% mark. How does domestication work? For long, it's thought that it entails a long process of meticulously breeding for specific features, like cows giving huge amounts of milk, established over many hundreds or thousands of years. But experiments in the Russian fur industry, especially those by Dmitry Baleyov in Novosibirsk, shed an entirely new light on the essence of this process. In fact, Baleyev showed, you have to concentrate on just one trait, and if you got that right, a broad range of other traits will automatically follow. This one key trait is docility or non-aggression. In little more than 20 years, he was able to breed a race of foxes as docile as domesticated dogs. And furthermore, they began to show traits remarkably similar to these animals. Curly tails, floppy ears, white spots, shorter tails, smaller skulls and teeth, and becoming very fertile, having their heat twice instead of once a year. And on the behavioral side, wagging tails, something wild foxes will never do, and of course their affectionate and docile manners. But only the last feature was intended, the others came uninvited. Furthermore, the process doesn't work the other way around. Selecting for floppy ears, white spots and shorter legs didn't produce tame foxes. Later experiments with rats and minks showed exactly the same result. When we turn to the wild nature, we expect to find wild, that is non-domesticated, animals out there. But is this always the case? When looking at chimpanzees and bonobos, it's clear they are closely related. Bonobos split from the line of chimps about 1 to 2 million years ago. To compare, we made this separation some 6 to 7 million years ago. Wrangham presents a very thought-provoking hypothesis. Could it be that bonobos went through a process of self-domestication? When we look at differences between chimps and bonobos, they resemble to a very high degree the differences between, for example, wolves and dogs, where the chimps are the wolves and the bonobos the dogs. Maybe a specific process of sexual selection took place. We already saw the big role females played in controlling interactions and conflicts between group members. The ladies intensely disliked bragging, aggressive and boisterous males. So the idea is they chose less masculine males to mate with, and they could do so by forming feminine bonds to dominate individual old-style aggressive males. This way, the gap between the physical appearance of males and females grew even smaller, because over long stretches of time, the females selected the least masculine males. Just like with Balaea foxes, breeding for docility leads to a number of traits typically associated with young and juvenile individuals within a certain species. Science calls this juvenilization and pedomorphism. And indeed, adult bonobos look more like young bonobos or young chimps than adult chimps do. Furthermore, their peaceful behavior is also tightly linked to juvenilization. Young animals are protected by their mother. She lets them play only with trustworthy others in a safe environment. So the youngsters have not much to fear of and don't have to think for themselves if certain situations contain danger or not. So young animals are good-natured, naive and full of confidence in others. But when they grow older, wander further away from their dens, and with no protective mother nearby, they have to rely more on their own judgment. And, better being safe than sorry, they become more suspicious, defensive and aggressive. In wild foxes, this period of carefree youth ends at about 45 days after birth. In domesticated foxes of Novosibirsk, this window is stretched to more than 120 days. And in some domesticated species, it goes on to far into adulthood. Also, the free sexual behavior of bonobos and the frequent homosexual interactions must be viewed in this light and are a combination of youthful playfulness and adult sexual impulses. Although domesticated animals usually have smaller brains than their wild ancestors, in bonobos, just as in humans and in a lot of other domesticated species, the brain parts regulating aggression, fear and impulse control are better developed. In humans, this is one of the cornerstones for our exceptional ability to cooperate. Did something similar as in bonobos happen with humans? When we look at the development of our own species for the last 200,000 years, we see some trends that point strongly to the idea that we have gone through a period of self-domestication too. When we study skeletons of early humans, males increasingly grew smaller and less muscular, becoming much more like females. So the gender gap between in body strength narrowed. This started some 200 years ago, and about 30,000 years ago, also brains became smaller. But note, smaller brains doesn't necessarily mean lower IQs. Some domesticated species with smaller brains do better at standardized tests like running mazes than their wild ancestors do. The smaller brains are especially about smaller parts for processing sensory input. But the key point is, we became more like infants. Comparing Homo sapiens with Neanderthals and Denisovan people, we see the same changes in genes as when comparing wolves to dogs. We are the dog version of Neanderthals. Our teeth, jaws, nose and face became smaller. At about 12,000 years back, we also see a drop in body length in the skeletons found. Maybe the process of sexual selection was enhanced by some other factors, pushing evolution in the same direction in a higher pace. For example, the climate got warmer, and smaller creatures are better at losing a surplus on body heat. Maybe there was less food available, or the invention of fire made big, strong jaws and teeth no longer necessary. Another reason might be the advancements of technology. Hunting with spears requires speed and superior body strength. Hunting with bows and arrows and advanced traps requires intelligence and coordination, but not body strength per se. Domestication not only makes animals less aggressive, it makes them also more cooperative. Maybe this has to do with a kind of naive disposition, going together with childness. Besides that, young age is the period we learn most. It's the time we trustfully adopt things from others and acquire new skills by imitation. Dogs, for example, pay attention to human signals. Wolves don't, and you cannot teach them to do so. Dogs, just like human infants, elephants, dolphins, and bonobos, perform remarkably well on the rope pulling test. In this experimental design, two individuals have to work together, pulling at the rope simultaneously to get the reward. If they don't cooperate, both of them will miss the reward. When the power of the individual human shifted to the group power, inevitably meaning individuals have to sacrifice some of their private power, and cooperation became the norm, our impact and efficiency grew exponentially. Much has been speculated why the physical stronger and bigger-brained Neanderthals got extinct and Homo sapiens didn't. Most scientists think it has to do with our superior skills in communication, cooperation, and the transfer of culture, that is, our ability to learn from one another. Men steadily grew into the direction of the feminist ideal, that is, limited sex differences, feminized men, monogamy, and women having much political power, just like with bonobos. Did we somehow copy their strategy? Females forming bonds, doing so making individual male aggression quite futile. So, males had only one option, to become cooperative, playing by the rules of the female powers. Sexual selection on niceness, cooperation, and female characteristics made the man into the man we see today, and which substantially differs from, for example, Neanderthal males. Maybe this process was enhanced by the concealment of the oestrus. In a species it is clear for men exactly when to fertilize a female, this usually enhances the competition between males, as we have seen with species like the sea elephant with big harems. The most aggressive and dominant males shield off females in their heath, and when he has fertilized her, he goes on to the next female. If, however, it is not clear when a female can be fertilized, as is in the case with the hidden oestrus in humans, males have no other choice than to stay with her and guard her off for her males at all times. We call this monogamy, and this is the foremost benefited the female strategy, trading sex against child care and protection. This increased ability to cooperate, however, benefited males too. They could take up much more demanding and ambitious endeavors than before. Among them, bigger and more effective armies, wars and cruelty to enemies. So, with warm aggression shrinking, cold aggression could grow. Remember the story of the peacock. When evolution takes a certain route, even if this is at first sight not a logic one, like the peacock's very visible and striking features, which makes you much more visible for predators, from a certain point on, it's better to join in the chosen direction than to resist. Peacock hens select for colorful feathers, even if this means their offspring is much more vulnerable to predators. Apparently, the big feathers benefited their son being chosen as mating partners in the future, weighing out the obviously disadvantages. The same goes for males losing a big part of their power. From a certain point in time, they help the females, the instigators of this strategy, to maintain this status quo. And this was the moment tyrants were not sure of their life and safety anymore. This was when the killing of tyrants, the execution of the most antisocial individuals, came in. Men grew into some kind of communist society in its purest form. Everyone is equal and do not try to become better or more important than anyone else, or you will regret it. Anthropologist Richard Lee reported on an incident he witnessed from the Yuhuanzi, also known as the Kung or San tribe. When a young man became especially skilled in hunting and provided a lot of meat, his spears became increasingly critical. His skills were debased, the quality of his meat was not good enough, it didn't taste that good, or it was too tough, but in fact it was of excellent quality. When Lee sometimes later asked people about it, they said, "If his pride would grow too big, he would go bossing others around, and he may even kill one someday." So they were constantly evening out the members of the group, so no big differences in status or self-esteem could emerge. This is why people in high positions are critiqued so much more than other people. "Don't think too much of yourself. We are all equals," is the ever repeated message. "Don't make yourself into something special. If you try to, shaming, ridicule, and ostracizing will be your fate." Even leaders becoming too much of a tyrant await these forms of correction. We complain about them, gossip spreads remarkably quick, and even little misdeeds are reasons for big upset. Overly boisterous men and leaders will first get subtle warnings, but if this doesn't change their behavior, in the end, the leader will be killed. Leadership in humans is much less despotic and selfishness than compared to the individuals in alpha positions in other species. They take the most and best food, have the females for themselves, and bully their way through life. Leadership is by definition selfish, but bonobos, chimps, and humans want something more. They demand a kind of servant leadership. We are equipped with special emotions to monitor the behavior of those in power or those with special competencies. We are outraged if a politician only works for his own interests. We want him to act for the best of the community, and for this he is rewarded with honor and dignity. But if he fails, he is punished even more strongly than he was rewarded. Capital punishment and mob killings of deviants is everywhere in human history. There are recorded cases of death penalty in Egypt, Babylonian, Assyrian, Persian, Greek, Roman, Inca, and Aztec societies. But not only in big civilizations. The same goes for hunter-gatherer communities. Anthropologists report of cases where deviant behavior, like stealing, raping, or even not sharing food, led to anger in the community. Which decided to correct the wrongdoer. When this had no effect, they saw no other solution than to kill him. The whole band was involved. Even after the man was dead, everyone still stabbed a spear in him, to show it was a collective decision and a collective act, just like the killing of Julius Caesar was. Even in newly formed communities like prisons and concentration camps, these kind of rules, based on our evolutionary instincts, form very quickly. In Auschwitz, for example, if someone stole bread from a fellow prisoner, the group killed him or made him being killed by guards. There is, of course, logic in this. Not doing it would make a difficult life even worse. Then you couldn't trust anyone anymore, and all last fragments of predictability would have been gone. So humans are a kind of natural democrats, maybe even natural communists. In small bands, we want equality. And this is a value we are willing to live and die for. Deviation from rules is not allowed. Every individual is equipped with instincts and inborn behaviors to keep in line with the norms of the group. Think of guilt, remorse, and shame. And every individual is equipped with detection systems to spot deviants. We do not have to learn ideas and feelings of right and wrong from holy scriptures or prophets. They are inborn, just like our distaste for poisonous substances and dangerous heights. Our self-domestication has molded us in a very special creature. Maybe instead of Homo sapiens, we might call ourselves Homo ethicus. At the same time, we need special skills of gifted individuals. People need to stand out from the crowd, especially the talented ones in times changes needed. These two opposing forces have to be balanced out for a society to be healthy and able to adapt to new challenges. That's why stories of individual heroes going their own way always appeal to us, as much as stories do about politics, the dramas of dictators and rulers, tyrants and selfish kings, from Shakespeare to TV series like House of Cards. We are constantly watching our kings and our elites, and they better be aware of it. Thanks for listening to this video, and I hope to see you in the next one.